أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله الطاهرين وعلى أصحابه المنتجبين وعلى جميع الأنبياء والمرسلين. Beloved brothers and sisters, elders, respected youth, as we enter the special month of Ramadan, I greet you with the Islamic universal greeting of peace. May the peace, the mercy and the blessings of Allah be upon each and every one. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. We enter the special month of Ramadan under extraordinary circumstances. And we wish each of you, your families and your loved ones, Ramadan Kareem. May Allah grant all of us the full blessings of this month of spiritual rejuvenation, of moral elevation and of behavioral correction. We're entering the special month of Ramadan, شهر القرآن, شهر الصيام, شهر القيام, شهر الغفران. The month of divine revelation, the month of fasting, the month of standing in the night prayer, and the month of forgiveness. We start off our glimpses into the glorious Qur'an from the beginning of the Qur'an, which is Al-Fatiha. Al-Fatiha is a surah that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam referred to as أعظم سورة في القرآن, the grandest chapter of the Qur'an. And furthermore, he said, هِيَ أُمُّ الْقُرْآنِ وَهِيَ فَاتِحَةُ الْكِتَابِ وَهِيَ سَبْعَ الْمَثَانِي, the mother of the book, the source of the book, the womb of the book, the opening of the book, with seven oft-repeated verses, verses which are recited in every rak'ah of any form of every salah. Al-Fatiha is also a dua, and it appears at the start of the Holy Qur'an as an introduction or a preamble to the Qur'an. Al-Fatiha was probably the fifth revelation that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received in Mecca, but it was the first complete surah to be revealed. The opening of the Qur'an itself begins with the tasmiyah, or the basmala, thereby setting a precedent for all Muslim activity, that whatever we begin in the name of Allah. And that's why the Prophet said, كل أمر ذي بال لا يبدأ فيه ببسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فهو أقطع. Any action of importance not begun with Bismillah is incomplete. Therefore the tasmiyah or the basmala begins the surah Al-Fatiha, and therefore it commences the whole Quran. So at the very threshold of our entering into the sacred book, entering into this final revelation, we are ushered into the awareness of the Creator by the introduction of His supreme name, Lafzul Jalala, the magnificent word, Allah. The word Allah is a perfect proper noun and, of course, a unique word. No plural can be derived from it, nor can you make a diminutive from it. Allah is therefore the distinctive name for the supreme being. In the Arabic language, the word Allah is never used for any being except the divine. It is a personal name of the divine, and Allah therefore introduces himself in the Quran by that name. Beginning with the Bismillah, we find it is followed by two of Allah's primary attributes, Ar-Rahman and Ar-Rahim, most compassionate and most eternally merciful. And we are thus made conscious of Allah's holy presence and reminded of His boundless grace and His limitless mercy. An all-embracing mercy, وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ, a mercy that Allah has made obligatory upon Himself, كَتَبَ عَلَى نَفْسِي الرَّحْمَةِ, and Allah has inspired the Prophet to inform us, مَنْ لَا يَرْحَمْ لَا يُرْحَمْ, that mercy will be granted to those who are merciful to others. It is highly notable that mercy is the first characteristic, the first quality introduced in the Holy Quran. The Fatiha then proceeds to refer to four divine characteristics. Rabbul Alameen, facilitator of the development of all levels of existence. Then reiterates Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, most compassionate, eternally merciful. Maliki Yawm al-Din, master, supreme authority, king of the period of recompense of the day of judgment, when everyone will be held individually accountable to Allah. Then follows the epitome of the prayer and the beginning of the dua or the supplication. You see, Allah is spoken in the first four verses in the third person. His names, His characteristics, His lordship, His authority. But in this fifth verse, Allah is directly addressed in the second person. And thoughtful contemplation of the first four verses create in a person such an attraction to and an irresistible longing for the Creator that is to satisfy this desire for closeness to Allah, for divine proximity to Allah, the direct address is now being used. In other words, if Allah is the divine, if He is the most merciful, Lord of the universe, supreme authority on the day of judgment, then إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. You, O Allah, we worship, and Your aid we seek. Through this verse, we acknowledge our relationship with Allah and actually commit ourselves in obedience to Allah. Then we find the dua proper. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Notice that the dua is اهدنا, guide us. It is in the plural. It shows that the dua is all-inclusive of others. It is devoid of selfishness. And how beautiful it is when people pray and they include you in their prayer and in their duas. The last two verses of the Fatiha pertains to the aspiration of human soul to attain spiritual elevation, constituting a plea for guidance for the Sirat al-Mustaqim. Ihdina Sirat al-Mustaqim, the straight path, the path of integrity, with a clear understanding of the distinction between Sirat al-Ladina an'amta alayhim and the other way, Maghdub alayhim wal-Dalin. In other words, we want the path of righteousness, not the path of wrongfulness. We want guidance to that path traversed by those who are worthy of Allah's favors. And we say in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, أُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ وَالصِّدِّيقِينَ وَالشُّهَدَاءِ وَالصَّالِحِينَ. We want guidance to the path traversed by those, the prophets, the truthful, the martyrs, and those who are righteous. We do not want to pursue al-maghdub alayhim wal-dalim, the path of corruption, the path of wrongfulness that leads to degradation and punishment. Upon the completion of the dua or the supplication of Al-Fatiha, because the whole surah in fact is a dua, we say Ameen, which means may it be so. And that is an affirmation of what we have read in the Fatiha. And therefore the Prophet said, إِذَا أَمَّنَ الْإِمَامُ فَأَمِّنُوا فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ وَافَقَ تَأْمِينَهُ تَأْمِينَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ غُفِرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ دَنْبِ. When the Imam says Ameen, then say Ameen, because whoever says Ameen, with the angels saying Ameen as well, then all previous sins of that person will be forgiven. In summary, the Fatiha could be considered a foreword to the Quran and a synopsis of some of the essential concepts that need to be understood. One, acknowledging Allah's supremacy, affirmation of Tawheed, and familiarity with Allah's primary attributes. Two, recognition of human accountability to the divine. Three, confession that Allah is the sole object of our worship and the primary source of our aid. Four, to Him alone we turn in supplication. And five, we understand the consequences of the choices we make, coupled with the awareness of the path of righteousness, which we want, and the path of deviation, which we do not want. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam said, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فِي التَّوْرَاةِ وَلَا فِي الْإِنْجِيلِ وَلَا فِي الزَّبُورِ وَلَا فِي الْفُرْقَانِ مِثْلَهَا إِنَّهَا السَّبْعُ الْمَثَانِي. By Him in whose hand is my soul, the Prophet said, Allah has never revealed in the Torah, the Gospel, the Psalms of David, in the Torah, the Injil, the Zabur, or the Furqan, the Quran, a surah like Al-Fatiha. It is the seven often repeated verses, repeatedly recited in every salah, and this surah is of such significance that the Prophet said about Surah Al-Fatiha, لا صلاة لمن لم يقرأ بفاتحة الكتاب. There's no salah without the recitation of Al-Fatiha. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.